feature Friday.
The freshest.
So this is a song that by a lot of you guys consider it as like an underrated gem. Maybe less people than what you think is worth.
Deserve to watch this.
Exactly. It's lower than what you guys think. It's still quite fucking popular. It's a composition by A.R. Rahman, and it's called Tumtak, or Tumetake. I'm not too sure. And it's from a movie called Ranjana.
All right, let's
or
have
Ranjana.
A look.
I don't know. You're very adamant we review this.
Oh, I remember those days playing papagayos.
Yeah, what
the
fuck? You guys play with that as well if you're watching from India?
What are they even called?
What do you call them in India? We call them papagayos back home in South America.
But what are they called in English?
Kites.
Right, you used to fly kites.
Yeah, weird.
That's so cool. We used to make our own in school.
I guess I've even seen it in America. Some people, kites is a thing.
You fly your kites.
Nowadays, kids buy them, don't they, off of Amazon?
Yeah, but
lazy fucks. We had to make them.
Yeah, we did.
And you had to see your dreams crush down because you were a very bad engineer when you're 7.
Or you always had that one kid that could make them better than everybody else in your class.
We also had this thing called trompos, which you sort of put a snail.
Do you know the Beyblades?
Yeah.
The toy.
Basically that, but we'll do it homemade.
Exactly.
Roll of that. Boom! But anyways, go on. Yeah. Maybe you guys have that as well, if you're watching from India.
Yeah. Is that look, the, is fly that... your kite. Also from the top of the roofs. I remember having to do that also back home.
It's a competitive kite flying. Go on.
Oh, have fun. It got stuck.
Right, so this got requested a lot from the previous videos because you guys were sort of like, oh, this has kind of like a similar vibe. Mm-hmm. You guys get to see a bit more of what the school life is. And I do want to highlight a few of the comments that you guys have sent us. So one of you went to a school. I mean, I'm not going to say the name because even though you did put it publicly, I still don't, you know, just in case. But it was a all-girls convent school, the comment. And it was quite strict from what you were telling me in the from what, you know, the girl was sort of said, telling in the comments. But that they're so happy that they sort of went to it because it is sort of strict, but it sets a great foundation and kind of sets you apart in colleges.
Good.
But yeah, all schools do have uniforms and the girls and all boys schools are quite common in India.
Cool.
From what I saw in the comments, but go on.
So like in this particular picture, you're seeing an all-girl school and he's watching from the outside.
Yes.
Get out!
They go to like a, what do you call it, co-ed school then?
Co-ed schools.
Fuck, you know, they had barbed wire on the thing.
Well, yeah, we never used to have barbed wire in our schools.
Well, not... No, you just have big ass fences.
Yeah, just really big
electric
fences.
Electric at the top.
Yeah.
Well, I think we went to a prison.
Basically, why? Why did they keep... I don't... Because that's the same. That's why you keep a kettle inside, right? It's like, I don't understand
why. Maybe it's just cheaper, maybe. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but why? Why use fences, people? We should be free. We're kids.
Yeah, but what about the people that, you know, get, like kids in a weird way? You want to keep them away, don't you?
Electric fences.
Exactly. Yeah. Ballet sometimes is very naive.
Hey.
You have a very beautiful mind.
No.
That everything is love and sort of...
No, I wouldn't say it's beautiful. I would say it's idealistic.
Yeah.
It's like, haha, let's all live in this world of rainbows and butterflies.
Yay. With no rules.
Freedom.
Because everyone will choose the right thing.
Yes.
No. No, they fucking wouldn't.
I would like to believe they would.
Yeah, you keep believing that, dog.
Listen, there's inherently good in people.
Actually,
even in the most of darkest minds, there's always good.
Ironically enough, in the piece of in the song so far, so, I mean, it's only been a minute, but in the song so far, it does have quite an idealistic chord structure.
Oh, yeah.
It is very hopeful.
Hopeful.
Yeah, and if you see, I mean, put the big screen there. If you do see sort of, again, the colours and the representations that each colour, they symbolise, you know, all across, you know, cinema and history, combined with such, you know, sort of beautiful chord progressions, you kind of start to see what kind of feel of a movie this is going to be. This isn't going to be a thriller.
You know, oh, definitely not. It actually fills you up with happiness. Yeah. I like this.
Story of young love.
Tourist. Who's the singer? I want to know who the singer is. Maybe it's in the description.
Javed Ali, Kirti Sagatia, and Pooja AV.
Right, so there's three different singers. That's really interesting.
Okay, cool. Go on. And I wonder if that's realistic to help guys kind of grow up in, you know, in sort of in those towns. You know, you go to school and then you fucking hang around with everyone in, you know, the townspeople and stuff like that.
Aww. Is it love?
She's chosen him.
She likes like, him just as much.
You know, it's interesting as well in the song. You know that twinkle, pull it back?
Yes.
Just for reference. That twinkle does a really great job of... Because there was a previous focus of his eyes, right? Mm-hmm. And that that's kind of a way that you describe when someone's falling in love. They had that twinkle in their eyes.
Yeah.
Their eyes...
Speak, we're alive.
Well, actually... physiologically speaking, when you see things you really like, or sort of when you're attracted or to something, you sort of your pupils dilate,
mm-hmm.
and then when you sort of don't want to fucking be around that person, you don't want to look at them, they constrict. That's actually where that comes from. But with that sound, it sort of exemplifies so much, because it's not only that they're dilating because he's obviously highly in love, it's also like as if everything in his life has now meaning and everything is now better. The pole he's holding feels warm instead of cold, like steel. Their fruits smell wonderful. The food that she's having looks delicious.
Yeah.
It's such a good fucking interpretation just that comes just from that little twinkle. Like, that's why those details, and this is why I think just sort of Bollywood in general does so well, and it connects with people in a different manner than other more traditional movies, so from the West do.
I totally agree. I wonder what she's eating, though.
Looks the fuck. Go.
Hey. Also, what part of India is this? Because this looks completely different to anything some we have seen so far.
Yeah, go on.
This is really cool.
Bro, he swung at him with a Will Smith open palm. What the fuck?
Yeah,
bro, if you're gonna swing, dog.
I don't know, because Efrat, you don't understand. A slap is like hurting people's pride. That's why
they didn't want to hurt his pride. There, look. They're fucking throwing down. And I mean, it's... 2 versus 2, 4, 6? You're getting your ass kicked.
Well, why were they looking up for a fight?
I don't know.
Just looking up for a fight.
Oh my.
Yeah, run it. Oh, he escaped. Oh, they're escaping. Yay.
Hey, no, he's helping him.
Oh, no.
They're just mates getting in trouble. Wow, that's fucking gorgeous.
Look at that place, though. Look at that set.
And again, the female voice comes in, then you sort of get the complete change of color palettes.
I was going to say, that's so distinct to the Bollywood movie element of music creating when it comes to music video making.
From what we've discovered so far.
Yeah, so far. Again, we're still babies when it comes to the whole idea of Bollywood and the compositions himself, but... more often than not, when the female singer comes into the picture, the color palette changes and the color grading also adjusts to the vocals in this particular idea. It's like the perspective of the storyline has changed.
Yeah, definitely. It does feel like that, actually. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
So you're seeing her perspective.
Her world.
Yeah. Also,
she's fucking wealthy then, it seems.
I don't think if it's wealth, but I think it's more of like she is a performer.
But isn't that what they're trying to sort of showcase? She goes to the food place as well. These guys are just like hanging out, that she's eating. while he is doing nothing. She's always doing activities. While he's getting in trouble, she's a performer.
Right.
That sort of what they're trying to exemplify? She is the better version of him.
Fair enough.
Better half.
Yeah, completely could be. I just saw it as in like different things interest them, but there's one thing in common.
They
themselves.
Both like each
other. Exactly.
Oh, okay.
I thought that was the focus here. But then again, open to interpretation, right?
It's just every time she's on screen, there are elements of wealth.
No, I think it's elements of being in the spotlight. She's always the spotlight.
Okay, fair enough.
See?
Yeah, that
she's
probably.
Always stealing the attention because she's just naturally
she's
that
it
type
girl.
Of exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what I see. I don't see it so much as in like, oh, I got all the money. No.
No, in that sense, it's just because maybe she goes to a private school where there's fences, and maybe their socioeconomic class is a bit different. That's why like her school has security.
Could be.
And his school doesn't because he's just fucking about doing whatever he wants.
Fair enough.
I probably would lean more towards your interpretation. I think that's probably what would be the most accurate. But we'll have a look at the lyrics at the end.
Absolutely stunning though. Gorgeous.
A bit of classical.
Also, I love the elongated sounds in the singing phrases in this particular song. They're so melodic, but they're so sweet at the same time. And it feels like the elongated M's, actually the humming part of the singing phrase, actually feels like it's a carried element of the thought process, as if you're like still marinating the thought as it's coming out of your mouth. It's really cool. I really like this composition.
It's just perfectly, and it's quite prominent in the Indian music industry too.
Definitely, but it is oddly amplified in this particular composition. Such an excitator.
Is it because he can't be part of it? He's not in the audience.
Yeah,
you see what I mean?
There's some
sort of segregation going on. And I don't mean it like in the actual sense of the word segregation. I mean it more in... Maybe he just doesn't have access to those.
Yes.
You know what I mean? I don't know. Go on.
Completely correct. Maybe this is like a private event, but I don't know why would it be, right?
Right.
Yeah, you're correct.
And they keep emphasizing that they're separated by things.
And he's always the outcast, watching from the outside.
Sort of like the Aladdin story.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah, I see it.
What's his name? Steve.
Aladdin.
Is that his actual name?
Yeah, Aladdin.
The boy. He's not a boy, a man.
He's
thief.
A boy. Yeah, it's Aladdin.
And what's the game like? Esmeralda.
No,
I haven't watched many Disney movies, I have to say.
Jasmine,
of course.
Jasmine. Esmeralda.
Whole new world.
Yeah, that's the one, yeah. Esmeralda is the girl from Hunchback in Notre Dame.
All right.
The gypsy girl.
Yeah, sure. So, Jasmine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she's a queen, right, or something. Princess.
She is a princess, yeah.
Yeah, and he's like a thief.
Yes.
A low life.
Yeah.
But he's got character and a personality. But anyways, go on.
Who is the heart of the princess?
Gives me this type of vibe.
Yeah, I see that. I don't know.
Oh. It's like a palace, bro.
Oh, yeah.
Holly.
Bro, she got handled.
She got fucked, dude.
This is what it's like to live with brothers. If you have brothers, you know what it's like.
And I don't think they're siblings. I just think they're mates.
But they grew up together type of mates, you know?
Here's the other interesting bit. So obviously, one of the intriguing parts of this piece is there's three singers, right?
Yes.
And now we're seeing the evolution into the later parts of the song. I would imagine at some point when they probably do encounter, if we're going to see that in the video.
I hope they do.
It does slow down. I would probably bet that it will return to the female voice. However, here we're seeing the later transition into the song. And you're sort of seeing the changes in timbre of each singer.
And also changing a change of rhythmicality in the song progression itself.
To demonstrate better... the point I always make of there is a huge the big issue sometimes of musical scores in some movies from all over the world actually is that sometimes they delineate instead of alineating.
Mm-hmm.
Furthermore, and it's kind of like investing. Like, it's really hard to sell it. Like, in 5 years, this will make you money. Or in 10 years, this will make you money. But you have to pay a lot of attention to that property for the next 3, 4, 5 years. But you will make money from it in 10 years, right? It's really hard idea to sell. It's the same kind of with this. If you pay attention to those details and you become more congruent and congruent with the musical score, mm-hmm. the scenes will grow in value. Yeah. And those they will become more memorable for the audience. Mm-hmm. So the fact that they chose three singers for one piece, that's obviously quite an important piece mm-hmm. anyways in the movie, does kind of highlight that to me, that they really do. It's like it's a baby. They treat this movie as like a baby and they truly nurture it and allow then the baby to sort of grow. And it grows on the audience, obviously, because, you know, 40 million views. People consider this as a gem. Mm-hmm. It works, you know, it truly works. But she is getting...
This.
It might be siblings, I don't know.
It looks like a sibling-like interaction. Whoa, come on, but let's talk about integration of meat cues in the freaking color palette. That is absolutely stunning.
Because the vocals are quite conflicting, they're quite chaotic.
Well, the whole scene is chaotic, right? And then you have a moment of clarity, absolute bang on.
See how the musical score adapts?
Perspective. But I just wanted to point out that usually, more often than not, in the Bollywood industry, the songs are made for the movie.
Of course, yeah.
Unlike other movie industries in the world, where the songs are integrated after the movie has been done, a lot of this missing out on details, like this one precisely here, it's so, you know, they miss these opportunities.
I think also it's that... Musical scores are obviously made, you know, alongside the movie in the West, of course. But songs aren't songs. Not the orchestral manner in which you approach a musical score in the West. Mm-hmm. Here they have really expanded that idea. And mm-hmm. it's like, well, musical score can also involve songs with lyricism and different singers. Rather yeah. than just having no lyrics. Because a lot of these musical scores, you know, if you look at some of the best ones of the latest 3, 4 years, Dune... Probably the only example that you have of that is theatre, and the best example of that that went to the cinema that did alright was The Showman.
Those songs showman, yeah.
actually have lyrics.
Yes.
But the musical score in the more traditional sense of the West doesn't have any lyricism.
Mm-hmm. Or it's not integrated in this manner, that's for sure.
No, that's true. Yeah. Well, because yeah. this is more theatre sort of.
Yes,
like, yeah.
it is. It's very theatrical. Ooh, yes, but listen to that.
Chaos.
Yes. Clarity. It's fantastic because then you integrate, because you had the moment in the music progression was so percussive forward, right? It was all about the chanting, like, I don't know, like football chanting, yep. Euphoric type of singing. And then she comes into the picture and the whole harmonic section of the song, it reintegrates into
that
the
chord
picture.
That's
yeah.
brighter than everything else.
And the harmonium becomes really prominent.
Yeah, lots to break down here because this is obviously such an important scene. Go
yeah.
on.
Oh, come on! This is a beautiful cinematography, like in the directions of the movie itself.
You know what's interesting? Because they just introduced...
Oh, he's about to get French.
The harmonium just mm-hmm. now, right? And just given the relationship between the music and the scene, because in the scene, he's now sort of becoming enchanted, right? By her touch. And then you're seeing the introduction of sort of the much more classical induced instruments, like the harmonium, like the tampura... the sarangi.
Sarangi.
Mm-hmm. So, in a lot of those scenes where we're sort of, in a lot of those videos that we've checked out in terms of how you practice and learn rag, you follow the melody of the tampura, mm-hmm. right, or a harmonium.
Yeah.
And you're just in a trance, essentially. Right, so the introduction of those instruments to me, I mean, I could be completely overinterpreting this, it could be likely, but I think it's probably like a reference to that because it's so ingrained in culturally, so ingrained, right? People understand that. Mm-hmm. It's like in the West, they use a lot the reference of a guitar.
Yes.
in relationship to love, mm-hmm. but it may be in India because, you know, rag is the beginning of all music. Maybe that's kind of the ref. Pull it back. Maybe I could be fucking.
But that's what she feels like. A shower, like a refreshing breeze. That also, she's like.
Isn't that flag? What the star and the moon. Mm-hmm. Is that a flag or is that like a symbol to something? Because the I think that moon, you see it in the Pakistani flag mm-hmm. with the star, I think.
Yeah.
If I'm not tripping balls.
I think you might be correct.
Let's see, Pakistan flag. But yeah. But it's kind of the opposite way.
Right, it's the other
so
way
it's like
around.
The opposite way. So maybe if there is a connection to that.
Interesting.
I love it.
It's beautiful. The vocalization here and the way that the vocals have been mixed, it is such a dreamy state of music. It really amplifies the mid-cue of the characters, the interaction between one and another, and the openness of the feelings. Because how often do you get that type of like open communication about the character's feelings? So shamelessly aware that this is how I feel and I'm gonna show you without any ounce of shame. That is so beautiful.
And that he hasn't had. Is that good English?
He hasn't had.
What had happened was, I fucking hate those type of sentences, so weird. But he didn't have to change who he was.
Exactly.
He didn't have to play Mr. Suave guy. Oh, he's actually just been the most him, dancing in front of her, being the showman that he is, being the clown that he is.
He didn't have to conceal his emotions.
Nothing. And that's she's in love
had
with.
To, yeah, and she hasn't had to pretend or play a game or try to get into this whole interaction. It's very open and I love this.
Cool young love.
Yeah, and it's so open. Yeah. I love that.
Little kid.
But the music.
The sitar.
And the music does a really good job of that, of reigniting that refreshing openness about it.
Well, my prediction was incorrect. We didn't return to the female voice. We actually returned to the original singer. Well, not the original, the primary singer of the song, which was the first sort of singer that started the song. And then we introduce a sense of serenity now. You've gone through the pursuit, you've gone through the realization, you've gone through the chaos. And now you're in the moment of serenity. You both know the truth. You're both in love.
This is fantastic. This is so beautiful. Oh, the kids.
Whoa.
How cool.
To the movies. I would imagine he's sort of being told, you have to go for it. Don't be like that guy. He's sort of seeing the woman of his dreams.
Just be married off to somebody else.
It's like good luck, right?
Yeah, well,
it's like a blessing. It's like a good
yeah,
luck.
That, I think that is one of the, I think it's a blessing. Again, this is the little bit I've learned to watching the three Indian movies I've seen.
Yes.
As far as
do
my knowledge goes.
If we're wrong, please, if you're watching from India.
It's like a good luck charm type thing. Oh, but you see how the vocal layers are starting to pile up as the progression of
tension,
the
tension,
yes,
tension, tension.
But it's lovely because what you just had literally previous to that cinema scene was absolutely dreamy. It was floaty and effortless, and now you're getting an overlay of vocals and more percussive forward without changing the chord progression. You're creating tension.
I want to watch this movie. You know what's interesting?
That's beautiful.
If everyone there knows that this is like a sign for good luck, maybe sportsmen do it, or maybe, you know, when you sort of have like a big deal. And everyone there knows as well. How adorable would it be? Because she probably knows she'll see it, right? Know what I mean?
Yeah.
How adorable is that? It's like, you win for a blessing and good luck just to see me, to hope that this goes well. That's fucking, that's great. Go on. I want to watch that movie. Ranjana.
Ranjana.
Yeah. Hey. Oh my god, look at the traffic.
Oh, take it off. Oh, take it off. Hi.
Fuck it. I have to watch it.
No, what happens after?
We'll watch it this weekend.
Come on.
This weekend, we won't. I do encourage everyone to tune in this weekend, actually.
Yes.
If I know a lot of you guys like hip-hop and, you know, us coming from London and sort of seeing the drill scene and, mm-hmm. and grime scene mm-hmm. grow worldwide, one of the artists that's going to join us this Sunday, it's a really well-known Korean rapper. And they're probably one of the deepest voices in Korea that Korea has ever had. And he does drill and he does rap and he does also R&B. So do tune in. His name is Bang Yong-guk. And tune in on Future Friday Plus 12 p.m. UK time, because it's actually a great podcast. I'm really proud of it. He really enjoyed it. And it's really cool when you are a fan of someone and then you get mm-hmm. a chance to speak to them. But anyways, these are the lyrics. All my wishes are limited to just you. My childish acts are limited to just you. My crazy sight is limited to just you. All my joy and sadness come and go. Limited to just you, my beloved. No. Limited to just you, my beloved. My requests are limited to just you. Then beyond that, whether you wish, whatever you wish, my requests are limited to just you. Then beyond that, whatever you wish, all my problems are limited to just you. Limited to just you. So tum taka means my requests are limited to just you. Arzimeri means to just you, I think. Go down. Because that sort of repeats itself. Okay. All my smartness is limited to just you and my readiness. Then he goes, don't search for the right moment, this silent, delicate heart of me and you. You, 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 you. Oh, tum, tum, tum.
Tum, 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 tum.
That's sick. Ah, I see. So you don't whip me with your eyes. You don't hit. You, 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 you. Don't throw killer gazes. Don't throw killer gazes. Towards you, tum taka. Right? Is that how they say it? Tum taka?
Yeah.
Towards you, I've started to walk towards you. Chalohum tum taka. That's sick. I love that fucking language. I'll keep walking towards you. I'm towards you. Milahun tum taka. I can be found towards you. I've started to walk towards you. I'll keep walking towards you. I'm towards you. I can be found towards you.
That's so playful. To be honest, can I just tell you something? This is
tum taka.
Romantic and fresh and open and
youthful
and it is lighthearted and the world needs this type of beauty. This
fantastic.
Is this is beautiful.
That's fantastic. Yeah.
I love it. Yes,
limited to just you. Limited to just you.
That's
so then you go. It looks upset that this face of yours, the black eyes on your face, the gaze and fight, they get bigger and bigger. May you be decorated. May my dreams be decorated, keeping your face in my eyes.
How gorgeous!
Take the glow of my eyes and the boat of my eyes. You're my paddle, you're my guide. I have to cross you, you're the storm. How will it cross this delicate boat of mine? That's actually a really cool, go up to that verse. That's actually the best way to explain when you have a crush on someone or you're in love with someone and you're yet to declare your love.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. It's like, take the glow of my eyes and the boat of my eyes and you're my paddle. Everything I do for this next couple of, you know, days, weeks, months, which I'm having this inner turmoil, this storm, of, you know, will she reciprocate? Will she like me back? Will she not? She's the storm.
That's right.
You know, and how and will you cross?
But she's also the boat. So
and the paddle.
The ignite, the, you know, the motivation behind every action.
And your heart is that delicate little boat. It's not a yacht, you know?
Yeah.
It might not survive a fucking storm.
That's right.
And it may change you after this.
Yes.
Maybe if it goes well, if it goes bad, you're definitely going to be a different person after you pass that storm.
Absolutely.
That's why I think that's the best advice I ever received. I actually received this advice in a club by the club owner in London. And he was like, whenever you meet a girl that you kind of get that feeling, like that kind of, oh, fuck, you know, and maybe it's not even romantically yet. She doesn't even know. Maybe you just sort of met. He said, that's a woman worth pursuing. Not even, she might not even have the personality traits you like or whatever. But the more you get to know her, obviously, you get to find out. But it's simply because you're training yourself that in moments of storm, wonder, worry, nerves, anxiety, you always plow through. So, and he says, and it's like a skill at the end of the day. It's like, you'll get used to it. The more you sort of do it, the least it'll become overpowering. The storm will break the boat.
Yeah.
And that doesn't mean that she's going to reciprocate every single time. No, that doesn't mean that you're going to get the girl every single time. But he said, you'll train yourself to act
under this type
and
circumstances.
Paddling moments of anxiety and nervousness towards your goal, towards what you wish, towards what you like, rather than drowning in the what ifs.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
this guy was really smart. The funny thing is, he also had very questionable advice as well for other stuff. But I really remember that night we were sort of just talking about that stuff, and he said that. I'm like, damn.
Yeah, that's correct.
I was like, he might be onto something here. You know what I mean? But anyways, go on.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
Then he just sort of goes to the chorus again, right? Limited to just you, tum taka, tum taka. Goes, my mind is crazy. Limited to just you, my youth is there. Limited to just you, my mind is crazy. My youth is there. My story has ended. Limited to just you, my story has ended. Limited to just you, tum taka, limited to just you, limited to just you. And that's sort of the ending, right?
That's beautiful.
This story will end however you desire to. Fuck me.
Wow. Like, it's literally, I'm on your hands. Whatever you decide, this will make me or break me, but both options are down to you.
The flattering moment, though, is, and this, nice. And I guess that's sort of what actually it means to be a leader. It's that he took the initiative.
Oh, yes.
That he was the one that grabbed her hand and disrupted her day. That he was the one that shook up her world. And he's putting it all on the line. And that's all you can ask for from a guy or from a girl or whatever.
That,
you know,
initiative.
Going
that,
for the pursuit,
yes,
of love.
Absolutely. It's. I think sometimes it's more attractive, the idea, not the ideas, the actions of this other person that you might find attractive, right? So what ignites the action? How far would they go? This is the type of things that I would find personally really flattering, right? So, and I think, obviously, we don't see a resolution
just
here.
Just get your reads right. Sort of, yeah. You know, don't declare her love after 3 days of fucking meeting her, you know what I mean?
Well, but why not?
Well, it depends if it's reciprocal.
But what not love? Okay, maybe not say I love you, but yeah. But do.
Interest, oh, definitely, fucking.
You know.
Oh, wait, don't wait, yeah.
You know, don't marry her, but I mean, do talk about it.
From what I found is, the longer you wait, the harder it becomes.
The more foggy everything becomes too. Like, what is this muddy waters?
But no, though, if you are in that position where it's sort of it's muddy waters, play to that shit.
No,
the allure and the mystery
the
of that, it's so attractive.
That is so long. Do not do that.
I found that so attractive with a girl. We both knew we liked each other, but we kind of just fucking played along to it. That we sort of, we didn't know where we were. And I find that so, what do you call it?
The play? The game?
It's the word they used to call flirting, but back in the day.
Courting.
That was so fucking fun for me.
Yeah, but the courting is different. Like, it's not muddy waters, though, anymore. It's pretty blatantly obvious.
All right,
what's
that's
happening.
It. But you're not in a relationship, or you're
exactly
not deciding. But, you, like, we hadn't even kissed or anything.
Yeah, that's courting.
Which was
that's
fucking
courting.
It was just so fun, because I had never been in a position like that.
Oh,
it was just fun.
Yes, yes.
And I was just so happy every day.
But, oh, wonderful. How nice. I just think, dude, just be clear. Go to the point.
Well, there you have it, guys. Do not take any advice from us. No financial advice. Hey.
Or romantic, yeah, for that matter.
But yeah, let us know what you guys thought about it. A wonderful piece. I'm going to watch this movie in the weekend.
It's a beautiful movie.
Goodbye.